Okay, we can just complete the method of joints since we have gone through many questions now. So, one of the important issue, remember, I again repeat the discussion on the internal rigidity, that is very, very important. The reason we are choosing a simple truss is because it is internally rigid. So, what happens? This truss internally rigid means it can rotate about 0.0 overhaul, let us say, but it cannot, no angle can change internally and the truss will actually collapse. Okay, so that is the basis of internal rigidity. But internal rigidity does not guarantee that the truss is going to be stable unless otherwise you support it properly. Think of it, if I just give it a roller, if I say let us say I have a roller at A and roller at C and I apply a horizontal force at B, is that a stable truss? Answer is no. The reason is I have a roller here, let us say I have a roller here and I am applying a horizontal load. So, there is no external reaction in the horizontal direction that will balance the truss. But remember that internally it is still rigid, internally it is not going to change any configuration even if it is collapsing. So, that is internal rigidity. So, it will collapse as a rigid body. Okay. So, going back to the method of joints again, we will just take up now simple problem. So, we have studied that for a given force P, if I just apply a force P, there may be members which can go to 0. Okay. And we know how to decide on those 0 force members. Now, let us try to study this problem. So, ultimately we have again a simple truss. You can just look at the basis. I can start from a basic triangular truss and I can form this truss with the concept we have developed, just extrude two members and go on like that. And also you can see that M equals to 2n minus 3, that is satisfied on this truss. Okay. So, M equals to 2n minus 3 is a thumb rule for the truss to be a simple truss, but remember it has to always made on the basis of two members extruded and then connected by a pin. So, now let us look at how do I solve this problem. So, 5 kilonewton, 20 kilonewton, 5 and 12, these are the forces that is coming in the joint. Okay. And now you have a hinge support here and we have a roller support here. Remember what is happening in this problem, we have only vertical loads, therefore reaction should also be vertical, there is no horizontal reaction, fine. Secondly, the truss is symmetric about this axis. That means the member forces BA must be equals to member force BC, BD should be equals to BF and ED should be equals to EF. Now, what importantly comes that when I am going to talk about method of joints, there are two things to discuss here. Either I can assume that all the members are in tension to begin with. To begin the process, I can just say all the members are in tension. That means when I am going to the joint equilibrium, that means I am taking the equilibrium of a joint, then I will show all the forces outward from the joint. Is that clear? So, that is the convention. So, you can now choose that, let us say I choose tension to be positive. However, you may want to choose tension to be negative also, but point that I am trying to say, just let us say we strict ourselves to tension to be positive and we carry this forward. So, for the time being we are bypassing the information on the nature of force. That means, if I can identify that the member is actually in compression, I could show that inward into the joint, but I am not going to do that at this point. So, I will show all the forces, member forces, to be tensile in the nature, and I will say that tensile force is positive, okay, and I am going to carry forward the sign as we move from one joint to the other joint. So, firstly, as we know that I can, since it is a simple truss, therefore, the entire truss is a rigid body. Therefore, I can calculate the reactions. I have no problem by taking the global equilibrium. Okay. So, I will calculate the reactions 21 and 21. Okay. So, next thing is that, remember, I will always start the process from where I have two member forces unknown. That means AB and AD are unknown here. So, therefore, I will go to this joint, and remember, this force is applied as it is, but member forces are taken as tensile. I do not know what the outcome would be. I will know the answer when I do the joint equilibrium. But remember, I have used tension to be always positive, and tension must be shown outward to the joint. So, what will happen if I do the equilibrium of joint A? I will get FAB equals to 0. Sum of force along x equals to 0 will give FAB equals to 0. That was also my special condition. Okay. However, if I do sum of force along y equals to 0, then FAD is coming to be negative 5. Since I have assumed tension to be positive, then negative 5 has to be compression. And what I will do, I will not change the sign in the next step. Suppose I want to go to this joint, I am not going to change the sign, okay, and we will show this later on. So, next thing is that since this joint is done, remember due to symmetry, FAB is equals to FBC, okay, that need not to be done. The next joint I have gone also joint E. So, let us say joint E will solve for the problem of the member force FEB. So, FEB, all the forces, remember I am always showing as a tensile force with a positive. Okay. If after performing the equilibrium, I get a negative answer, then it is actually a compressive force. Okay. So, ultimately you can see that FEB is going to be 12. Similarly, now what I can do, since I have gone to a complex joint, I have gone to joint B. Remember, FBA is solved, right? FBA is 0, same as FBC. FEF is already solved, that is FBE, right? FBE is 12, that was in tension. So, what I will do? I will again show everything as a tensile here, as I have shown here. So, all are positive as such. And I am going to carry forward whatever sign I got from the previous step of these forces. So, I just set the joint equilibrium again. So, remember, if I do a horizontal joint equilibrium, then FBD is equals to FBF, and for the vertical equilibrium, now pay attention to this. Vertical equilibrium suggests FBD and FBF are equal. So, 2 times FBD cosine of theta plus 20 plus FBE equals to 0. I will simply take the value of FBE from this, substitute here with sign, not the magnitude, also with sign. If it would have been compressive, I am going to take the negative sign from here and substitute back here. My ultimate outcome would be FBD must be equals to FBA equals to negative 34. Clear? So, ultimately in the process, we have actually solved for all the member forces. Okay. Now, let us look at joint D. I am yet to calculate, I think FED is not calculated. FED was not calculated, right? So, to calculate the FED, just check what I have done here. To calculate FED, that was my still unknown, I have taken help of joint D. Joint D, remember, has a support reaction that is coming the way it is. This is external load. But FAD, FBD, FD, everything was shown as tension. Although I know this is in compression and I am trying to find out what is the answer for this. This is in compression, this is in compression, but I showed it as a tension. I then use the equation like this. This is the horizontal equilibrium, right? Okay. So, FD plus FDB cosine of this angle should be equals to 0. Remember, interestingly, FDB, that sign, I have taken with sign. So, negative 34 will be substituted and therefore, FDE will become positive. That means, FDE is actually in tension. Clear? So, the one way of doing it, that you don't change the nature of force as you go from the joint to joint. Just stick to it your sign convention. Whatever you get with sign, you bring it to the next step. Do not reverse the force on the joint. Do not reverse the direction of the force on the joint. That means if you got a compressive force in the previous joint, don't just say it is inward in the joint and do the equilibrium. In that case, remember, if you do inward, then actually you have already incorporated the sign. So, during the equilibrium, sign is not coming into play because equilibrium does not know sign. Okay. Now, check would be whether this joint is actually under equilibrium. Okay, then did I actually satisfy that vertical equilibrium is 0? If I check that, you can clearly see, yes, absolutely correct. So, if I do the vertical equilibrium and bring in all the signs here, then you should get it equals to 0. Clear? So, this is assuming all member forces are tensile at the beginning and we are choosing tension to be positive from the very beginning and we are consistently adopting that towards the, you know, thoroughly in the analysis. The other way of solving it, as I said, that you can first calculate one joint and you can reverse the, you know, show it in the direction it is actually be in the next joint. Okay. So, likewise, let us look at the second problem. So, in the second problem, what we have essentially, this is the truss. Again, remember, it is a simple truss. It is internally rigid and it is supported properly. You can see clearly that you have one hinge here, one roller here. Okay. So, there is no way that it will you can make this structure unstable. No matter how you apply the force, it is always going to sustain that load. Okay. So, now you see that how I start the process. Process is simple, that first I try to calculate the reaction because entire truss is a rigid body, I should be able to get the reactions. Okay. Then what do I do? Remember that I have only two unknown forces here, right? So, I can start from this joint and then subsequently if this joint is solved, I can go to joint D, solve for these two, then I can move to joint this one, solve for these two, come here, solve for these two. And then we can do again a cross check right here. Okay. So, in that way methodology will be systematic. Now, here only thing I am saying that I am not going to adopt the sign convention that I have done in the beginning. So, here I am going to restrict myself with a nature of force. Nature of force means is it a tensile or compressive? And I am going to always show that in the joint accordingly. So, to start with, as I said, calculate the reactions. So, I am skipping this because everyone knows this is a rigid body and how to get the equilibrium of this, that has already been done in 2D equilibrium. So, those reactions can be obtained. Then you look at it the joint A. If I start from joint A, what is happening? If I want to draw this forced polygon, that means here it's a triangle, I can clearly use the triangle rule even. Naturally, what will happen? You can clearly see that this member will be in tension and this member will be in compression. So, AB will be a tensile and AD will be under compression. Okay. So, therefore, you can also use the equilibrium of this to get the value of AB and AD. Okay. So, whenever it is shown like this, this is AD, that means on the joint, it has to be inward to the joint. And here, FAB, the outcome will be, it is outward from the joint. So, I get this answer. Then I move to the next joint. Can I do that triangle again? So, I know already FAD, right? To make it closed circuit, I must have FDB like this, FDE like this. The directions are already frozen. You can't otherwise close the circuit. You could also do a sum of force along x 0, sum of force along y 0. Okay. So, ultimately what is happening in this case, using the triangle rule, you can also get the answer. The point that I am trying to make, remember what has happened, since I know FAD from this, which was in under compression, I have actually shown this like that in this joint. So, look at joint D, I have actually reversed, right. So, it was nature of force that is being shown, that is a compressive force on AD, on the joint it is inward. So, let us now move on to joint. So, that is just using the force polygon or triangle rule if you want to do. However, you can always do sum of force along x, sum of force along y. So, let us look at joint B now. If I go to joint B, what are my known? Known was already FAB, that was known. See, I am showing it as a tensile because it was tension. Similarly, FBD was found as a tension, so I have shown it as a tension. Now, I have no choice, I have to assume what these two are. However, you can use also force polygon, does not matter. This will give you the direction a priori. For example, in this case, both will be actually in tension. You can show that using the equilibrium. So, sum of force along x 0, sum of force along y 0, I can clearly see if you even use polygon concept, this will be in tension, this will be under compression. So, now you move on to this joint, joint E. So, in the joint E, again remember once I go to joint E, I already know the solution, this solution was known, this solution was known. Right. So, it was shown. So, this was compressive force. So, it is showing acting in this joint in compressive manner, that is inward in the joint. Similarly, this was compressive inward in the joint. I do not know the solution of this yet, let us say. Then I just do sum of force along x equals to 0, I get this answer. So, it is again going to be a compressive. If you do a polygon, you are going to find that FEC has to be in under compression because to close the polygon. Okay. So, next what we can do, we can simply check at C. So, we can do a check at C that whether the equilibrium is satisfied. So, these are the two checks I am doing to say that okay, joint equilibrium is satisfied at C. So, the point that I am trying to make here, or what we have studied, that I have two choices. The first choice is I can start with all joints, you know, all forces are to be under tension. I will use positive notation for that and I will keep following that sign convention throughout the joint equilibrium. The other way of doing it, first I start from a joint where there are only two unknown forces, I decide on their sign first, that means using the polygon rule or even joint equilibrium. Once those two nature of the forces are frozen, I can go to the next joint where again two member forces are unknown. But on that joint, I am reversing the, you know, I am showing the force depending on their nature. That means on the joint, if it is compressive, it should be inward. If it is tensile, it should be outward. Clear? So, any question regarding method of joints now? Yeah.
1178.
1178.
Sir, if it has find out to internal hinge whether it is acting at anywhere, how to cooperate with that?
The internal hinge was solved in the 2D equilibrium or not? Usually these are typically, so your question is internal hinge. If there is an internal hinge, then how I solve the problem, right? See, internal hinges are typically used, you know, kind of girder or beams, okay? The remember what internal hinge cannot take the moment. The only issue is that internal hinge cannot take the moment. So, it is almost like a pin joint, okay? So, when you say, let us say you have a beam and two beams are connected by a internal hinge and you apply a load, then again you can treat them as two separate rigid bodies, okay? So, you can simply treat that two separate rigid bodies, but remember when you disjoint these two bodies, when you disconnect the two bodies, right, then you have only the vertical reaction or horizontal reaction that is going from one body to the other body, okay? Now, think like this. So, I just want to use, just to deliver the concept of internal hinge. See, the for internal hinge, typically so let us assume that this end is fixed, okay? So, how do you separate this body? Let us say this, now first of all remember for internal hinge, if I have an internal hinge here, okay? So, what happens? You see that first of all make sure whether it is a statically determinate problem or not. That is the first thing. How do you ensure it is a statically determinate or not? So, fixed end here will have three reactions. And you detach the body, here I have one reaction, right? So, in internal hinge, since there is no moment, the force will be transferred like this. So, you have only two reactions, horizontal reaction and vertical reactions. Remember, as per Newton's third law, what are my, this is equals to this, this is equals to this. So, ultimately what I have, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, total 6 unknowns and 2 rigid bodies. Okay? So, 2 rigid body, that means 3 equilibrium equations each. Okay? So, I have really total 6 equations. So, this is a perfectly statically determinate problem and I can solve it. Now, in truss, we do not say it an internal hinge, but think of like this, and we are going to come to this. Suppose I have a truss like this, it has internal member, but remember, let us say, you know, this is a simple truss. I have one truss like this, then I have another truss like this. Okay. Now, if I have something like this, so there, let us say this is a simple truss and this is a simple truss. Okay. Now there is no concept of internal hinge, but suppose I take these two trusses and joint these two together here. So therefore, what will happen? You can clearly see that. See, therefore, we can have a truss. I can have a truss like this, and then I can have a truss like this. Okay, now they are jointed together. Therefore, you know, something like this will come. Okay, so now this is, as you are saying, it could be called as an hinge here. This is internal hinge. Now, to make it perfectly stable, what I need appropriate supports. But concept remains same. Now you are treating as such two rigid bodies, right? As if I have two rigid bodies, and therefore I require six unknowns. This will already take two unknowns. This will already take two unknowns. Then I can support it properly by saying I have hinge here and I have hinge here. Okay? And here, remember, at this particular joint, what is happening? And we are actually going to study this next. We are going to do that next also. So for internal hinge analysis, just remember that we do not have any moment about there. However, we have only two reactions that will be transferred from the one body to the other body. Okay? ठीक है? So we are going to study the internal hinge also when we talk about compound truss. Just hold on to that, okay? ठीक है? But for beam and for truss, they will be different. Okay, but mechanism remains same. Mechanism is going to be same. Okay, now what we are going to do, we are going to go to a next analysis technique, that is method of section. Okay, so we can again analyze a truss by method of section. Now, why do we need it? Although we have method of joints, which can solve for the truss if it's a statically determinate, the method of sections, however, used to solve, let's say, a particular member force or a few member forces in a truss. Okay. Now, systematically, what it does, if I want to get a solution of few member forces in a truss, it may not be desired that the truss is too long. And I am asking somewhere, you know, some forces in the middle, it may not be desired that I start analyze the truss from one end and go and try to find out the member forces, you know, at the middle of it. Okay? So that's the whole idea. So method of joints in that case can be very lengthy process, but method of joints can solve the problem. So what we are going to do, we are going to now take method of sections. So what we do, idea is that we'll run a section and we'll treat the bodies that are on the left side as a rigid body and the right side also as a rigid body. So if I cut few members here, I am going to expose the member forces. Okay? So if I expose the member forces, then I can again simple treat this one as a rigid body. Remember, this was a simple truss. I made a cut here, right? So this part is a rigid body, this part is a rigid body. Because both of them still are simple truss, rather they are basic triangular truss now. So therefore, now due to this cut, due to this section that is running NN, I am going to have FBD, FB and FC. Okay, so these are the three forces that are exposed. I have my unknown forces exposed. Then suppose now I want to solve for what is the force in BD. Can I solve it? What is the force in BD? Remember, this rigid body now have three unknowns, and you can always solve it by sum of force along x 0, sum of force along y 0, and moment about a point equals to 0, right? That is the whole concept. Now, how do I solve f b d in a fraction of second? I can simply take the moment about point E. So, join these two forces at point E and take the moment about E, and that will solve for f b d in terms of p 1 and p 2. So, let us look at this concept carefully now for some bigger problem. Okay. So, remember you can take different sections depending on what you are going to solve. However, in a section, if I have three unknowns, I should be able to solve for all the three unknowns, because the left free body diagram or the right free body diagram will have only three unknowns, and they can be solved using the standard equilibrium equations. That is sum of force along x 0, sum of force along y equals to 0, and moment about a point equals to 0. Now, in this problem, it is an example of a pink truss. How I am going to solve it? The force in members CD, CE and BD needs to be solved. So, CD, CE and BD. If I want to solve this, firstly, remember this is again a simple truss, and you can say that it is a thorough rigid body here, proper rigid body supported by, you know, the reactions here is hinge, and here you have a roller. So, I am going to get two reactions here. Okay. And this can be first solved since it has a symmetrical loading pattern. Therefore, you can say that total load divided by 2 will be the reaction here, total load divided by 2 will be the reaction here. Okay. There is no horizontal force. So, suddenly A x would be equals to 0. So, now how do I cut the section in order to find out B D, C and C D? Basically, as we see, we have to run a section like this, so that these three member forces are exposed. So, once we expose these three members, as we see here, F B D, F C D and F C is exposed, right? Now, we can treat this small part F B C as a rigid body. So, now this becomes a rigid body subject to these set of forces, where I have three forces as unknown, and therefore, I should be able to solve it. So, all the three forces can now be solved. Okay. So, how they are solved? Now, there are few tricks involved. For example, can I get the solution for FCE? Can FCE be solved directly? The answer is yes. How do I do that? By taking moment about D. If I take moment about D, remember these two unknowns are passing through D, therefore, they will not contribute to the moment. So, we take the moment, okay, and then what we can see is that this is the force in that member. Remember, the answer that is coming is actually positive, that means it is on the direction that is chosen, and it is shown, it was taken earlier as tensile force. So, it remains as a tensile force. Clear? Similarly, what we can do, sum of moment about A equals to 0. Now, if I take sum of moment about A equals to 0, okay, then F B D and F C is not going to contribute any moment about A. Therefore, F C D can be solved. The answer will be plus 6.25, that means it is going to be tensile, that means it is actually the direction that was chosen, that direction stands. So, therefore, it is a tensile force. Now, if you simply do sum of force along y equals to 0, then we are going to solve for the F B D. Okay. and FBD will come out to be a compressive, there will be a negative sign in this case. Okay, it is going to be negative here, just and therefore that will be a compressive, because we have taken FBD as tensile earlier, right. So, therefore, if I get a negative sign, that will be compressive force. So, ideally it is very simple. So, ultimately I am just cutting a section exposing three unknowns and taking the equilibrium of the left free body or the right free body. Now, in this case, I have taken the left free body because that will make it simpler. I could have also taken the right free body, that would be more complicated to analyze because there are many external loads on the right segment. Now, how about this? Now, this is a K truss, inverted K truss. You can see here. So, what is shown here, just let us say one side of it, one frame of it, and it is a K truss. All of these are pin joint as it is. Now, you can see that I am interested in finding out force in member GJ and IK. That means this force right here and IK right here. Now, can I solve it by method of joints? Answer is yes. To solve by method of joints, remember I could have started from this joint right here and progressively I can solve for all the forces. But that will be very tedious because I am interested in finding out GJ. Okay, so I have to solve all the forces in order to get into this GJ, because although I will know the reactions, I can't start from any of these joints. Even if I know the reactions, because it is a rigid body, simple truss, and you can see even if I start from here, I can't start the method of joint because there are three unknown forces. So, method of section will be very appropriate, but how do I take the section? Remember, my objective is to find out GJ and IH, and it is not necessary that a section has to be always a straight line. So, I can take a section in a very different manner, so that these two unknown forces can be solved. So, remember what we can do, think of just detaching this part, just simply try to detach this part. So, that means this portion I need to cut out, this triangle G, J and K, because I know the reactions. Once I take this out, then the type of section now I am talking about is kind of curved section. That section will run through GJ, GH, HI and IK. Now, that will solve the problem and we will see interestingly what is happening. So, that is my section. Now, the section is X prime X. Okay? And once I do this section, what is happening? Remember, in the process, what will happen? I will have this truss intact. This is my basic triangular truss. I will expose this force, that is GJ, HG, HI, and KI. These are the forces going to be exposed. Now, you think of this is a rigid body, it will have its own reactions. So, reactions will be Jx, Ky and Jy. So, that we can solve from the equilibrium of the entire truss at the beginning. Okay. Then, now interestingly what will happen if I just consider the free body diagram of this truss with the forces, unknown forces and the reactions acting, and I take a moment about point G. So, if I take a moment about point G, this force and these two forces are not going to contribute. Okay? So, only thing that is coming up is I have one unknown force to solve, that is Ki, take a component, multiply by this distance, right? So if I take the moment about this point, only ky is my unknown, all others are going to be known and I can solve for ki. Okay. Similarly, to solve for gj, I can simply take moment about I. If I take moment about I, then you can clearly see that gj can be solved. Okay. So, the idea is that method of section, when we are choosing the method of section, depending on what is demanded in the problem, the unknown forces that is demanded in the problem, we have to choose the section appropriately in order to get those forces. And it is not necessary that I have to always expose, you know, I have to always take a straight cut. I can also make a curved section to get the unknowns, right, that is desired. And here also you have observed that in the process I am actually exposing four forces, four unknown forces are exposed, right. Although I can still solve for two unknown forces, that is gj and ik. So, method of section is clear now.